Well, good morning, people. Welcome, welcome, welcome. A warm welcome to those on Zoom. It's nice to have you, the Zoom family. Welcome. Welcome to those who are here in the Student Y Hall. I see some visiting faces. It's nice to have you on this Christmas day. I'm going to open with a passage from Isaiah. God has announced judgment on Israel, and he will use the Assyrians as his instrument of judgment. But he has a promise to them despite what will come. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. Then verse 6 says, for to us a child is born, for to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. What a great promise from Isaiah about the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to open in a word of prayer this morning. Why don't you pray with me? Father, thank you that we can gather as your people. Thank you that we have technology. Thank you for Zoom. Thank you for people from different parts of the world. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you that we celebrate the Lord Jesus' coming, that he stooped down to earth into the mess, the brokenness of this world. Thank you that you have drawn near with promises of your Son. Help us to reflect on the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, the reason for the season. And so, Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit to move in our hearts and our minds as we sing these songs together. In your name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand and we're going to sing some songs together. Why don't you stand and join me?
Of our dear Savior's birth.
Father, thank you for those words. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that Christmas is more than just about gifts and Christmas trees and Christmas lights and family and gammon, but it's ultimately about your Son who came down in love for us to offer us healing and wholeness and restoration. So thank you for the gospel. Thank you for the good news that Jesus loves us, that he came to die for us so that he can restore us to a loving relationship with you. Father, I pray that this Christmas, you would impress those truths on our heart afresh this morning, that we would believe them by faith and trust in you. Thank you for the promises of Christmas. Thank you for your son. Amen. You can take your seats. We're going to continue worshiping God. We're going to continue worshiping God in prayer. Paul's going to come up and just pray for us now.
Right, morning, everyone. Let's spend some time praying together. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find him a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger. Suddenly a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angels, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." Father, we thank you that that is what we come to celebrate this morning. Thank you that there is indeed good news for all people, there is glory to you because you have sent your son and you have brought peace to us and you brought peace between you and us. And Father, in that we rejoice this morning. We thank you that despite what 2020 has been like, despite the difficulties, the good news of Jesus remains good news. Father, we long for his return when we endure a world like we have this year and when the virus is still running rampant across our country and across the world. We long for the return of Jesus, the day when he will come back as king, when all the world will recognize him as such, when everyone will bow down before him, and ultimately he will fix this world up. You yourself, Lord God, will come down and dwell amongst us, and we will be your people, and you will be our God, and you will remove every tear and every ounce of pain, every sadness, you remove death. We long for that great day. But Father, as we live in this world that is so broken, may we be a people that declare the good news, not in a sort of a otherworldly, foolish way, sort of make-believe way, but with utter conviction that the hope that we have and the joy that we experience, that people will see it in our lives as we endure and as we struggle ourselves with the broken world. May they hear it in our lips. May they see it in the way that we live. May they experience it in the way that we care for them and we show the good news to them that we have to share with them. Father, I pray for those within our congregation this morning who have found this year particularly difficult. I pray that they will find rest, that they will enjoy and experience afresh the joy of knowing that the Savior has been born to us. Strengthen them, encourage them. For those who are lonely or perhaps remember the loss of a loved one over this particular time, Lord, comfort them, draw near to them, and remind them again of the hope that we have. Father, for all of us, may we savor Jesus. May we remember him as our Savior. May we turn from the idols that so grip our hearts. May we rejoice in him, we pray. Grow us as a church, Father. Grow us in our witness. Grow us in our faithfulness to you. For your name's sake, we pray. Amen. I love you guys.
Thanks, Paul. As you, many of you will know, that's Paul's last Sunday. Sorry, we've just had a small problem. It's Paul and his family's last Sunday, so give them a big hug. We're going to miss you guys. We love you lots. We'll be praying for you. A warm welcome to those of you that maybe come in a little bit late. My name is Gerard. If you're visiting or here for the first time, it's great to have you. If you're watching on Zoom, it's also great to have you. Thank you for joining us. Just a few announcements. The first one is we'll be starting on the 10th of Jan 2021. So that first week, I think it's the third, there won't be a service. We'll start again on the 10th of Jan. Other than that, thank you to Marcus, who will teach the kids this morning. So the kids can go to Sunday school. I'm going to call. Okay. The Bantam family will also be leaving us. They will be joining the Schoenfelds, and we're going to have a farewell and prayer session for them, I think, in the new year, once we hear that your visas have arrived. So we'll be praying with you too. Cool, the kids can go out to Sunday school. Sands, you can come up. Yes.
Whew. It's good to be up front because get to take off this mask, man. Yes, it's hard to breathe. But good morning to you, Zoomers. Good morning to everyone. Just to add to a little bit of notices for you, Zoomers, as well as you guys live. I'm going to take this off now so that you guys can focus on what will be said. Otherwise, you'll be looking at me the whole time. But just keep Wandile and Tumisa in your prayers. They drove about 14 hours. So Ntobeko went with Spogazi and Wandile to drive to the Eastern Cape. Today is the negotiation, Lobola negotiation for Wandile. And tomorrow will be their ceremony, wedding ceremony. So just keep them in your prayers. But also on the 27th, Moratua or Ratu will be getting married to Michael. So keep them in your prayers. That is the 27th of December. I think that's in terms of notices. I'm going to pray and we're going to look at God's word together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are God who gives life. We thank you that you are God who's allowed us another opportunity to be gathered. And I pray that as we hear your word, as we think about it and reflect on it, we may find our hearts encouraged in reflecting on the true meaning of Christmas. May our hearts, with the reminders that we'll have, be enabled to live for you in faithfulness to the praise and glory of your name. It is in the name of Christ our Savior we pray. Amen. What comes to your mind when you first hear the words Christmas? What do you think Christmas is all about? What fills your head and mind when you think about Christmas? I'll tell you a little bit about what fills my head when I think about Christmas. There's three things for me, my younger self, that always made Christmas a thing to look forward to. One was the Christmas clothes that you only wore on Christmas Day from 12 o'clock midday. The very next day, those clothes are off. They're only Christmas clothes. Number two is what we used to call the seven colors, where on a table at when you came to have lunch, you had all the different kinds of food that you could find. And growing up and being in a township, that was only a day on Christmas, where what made that seven colors very special was the cool beetroot in a bottle, as well as mayonnaise to go with the chicken and the rice. That made Christmas for me growing up. But the third one, and this, for many of us, it would be like, but for someone like me growing up, this made Christmas truly Christmas. And that was the assorted baker's biscuits. That box that used to be on the top of the cupboard that does not touch. It was probably bought at the start of the year, but only to be consumed on the 25th of December. And so growing up, those were the three markers for me that meant that Christmas has arrived. New clothes, seven colors, and baker's assorted biscuits. Now, when you think in the world, what is Christmas all about? When you think about what we reflect in the world, these are some of the things that people think Christmas is about. It's a day for lots of food and lots of drinks. In fact, in the township, as I got older, I would visit for Christmas and I would see just how wasted people could get. It was like that one day where you had a license to get wasted. Christmas, maybe for most of us here, certainly for most people living in the world, is about gifts. Whether you are buying the perfect gift, looking for the perfect gift wrap, or you are the one tearing into the wrapping paper to see what you've got, for most of us, Christmas is about the gifts. It's about the giving and the getting. I was in PE with my wife for a couple of days, and it was actually amazing. We went to this store called the Lemon Tree, right? And my wife's delight, the glee on her face, it's just like, I've arrived. And she was just going from corner to corner. And this store is huge. And she was looking for the perfect gifts that she could wrap up nicely in that perfect wrapping paper to give to those people she considers friends when the time comes, whether it's a birthday or Christmas. But for most of us, it is about that. It's about giving gifts or getting gifts. There is also the Christmas tradition. As you can see, we've tried to have a little tree here with some lights, because for many, that is actually what Christmas is about. It's about having the lights. It's about having fun. It's about celebrations. And if you're Christian or religious or spiritual, you want to add a little tag there and say, well, Christmas is actually remembering a birthday. It's remembering that the Lord Jesus Christ was born. And if all that Christmas is for any of us, if it's simply about eat as much as you can, drink as much as you can, give gifts, take gifts, Christmas tree and lights, then we are of all people to be most pitied. There's so much more to the meaning of Christmas. There's something greater about what Christmas ought to be about. And I hope that for the remaining few minutes, I can take you through one of the stories written by someone who knew Jesus, who saw Jesus, and is telling us about what Christmas is really about. And I hope that when you go and do the gifts giving, the gifts unwrapping, you will think of this, the true meaning of Christmas. Our story comes to us in the Gospel of Matthew. And I'm going to take us there, chapter 1 of Matthew, and I'm going to read a few verses and explain them as we go along. So if you have a Bible, Matthew chapter 1, from verses 18. And I'm going to be reading in the NIV from verse 18 of chapter 1, Matthew. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. I really just want to focus on two verses in that section that I've read. I want to focus on verses 21, that Jesus is the name given because Jesus will be the savior of the world by forgiving people their sins. I also want to focus on verse 23 that tells us that another name given to Jesus is Emmanuel, which means he is God with us. I wonder if you remember last week's sermon, which really produced a lot of tears for me as I listened from PE, as Jared was reminding us an invitation that comes from Jesus in the same gospel later on. How in this invitation of Jesus saying, come to me if you are weary and burdened and I will give you rest, there was that offer that Jesus gives to say, he alone is the one who really reveals God to us. That in this invitation, Jesus is the one alone who offers rest, physical and spiritual. That Jesus is the one who comes to us and he reveals his heart as being gentle and lowly. I hope that you remember those things and that you will take those things and you'll add them to today's talk about Jesus, the one offers salvation by forgiving sins. Jesus being God with us and amongst us. It's not really hard to imagine this man, Joseph. The Bible describes to us that he was a man who was righteous, as a man who feared the Lord. And when he heard that his wife-to-be is pregnant, of course, the logical thing to think is, who done it? You know? Because, like, you're about to get married to me, and you're telling me you are knocked up? It just doesn't make sense. And so as he's contemplating this, as he's thinking throughout the night, he's troubled. And God, as God used to work, and God still sometimes might work, he comes to Joseph in a dream through an angel and explains what exactly is happening to his wife-to-be. And in the words that the angel of the Lord gives to Joseph, we are told at the end of that section that I read, verse 24, that he woke up, he did exactly what he was told, because he had believed what the angel of the Lord had said about what Mary is carrying. And what is it that the angel says to Joseph? Well, he tells him that the child that his wife is to bring into this world is the savior of the world. And he tells him that the way that this child will save his people is by forgiving their sins. And that statement obviously comes to us packed with implication. That statement of he will save his people from their sins implies that we've got a problem, and that the problem is the forgiveness of sins. Now, I wonder when last you thought that my biggest problem, your biggest problem, is that you need your sins forgiven. I think so many of us live life thinking that there's so many things that we need rescue from, that we need and return to for security, that these things become our functional gods. Yet God's story, God's creation says that the biggest problem that any of us have is the need for our sins to be forgiven. And this is why Jesus came. This is why we celebrate Christmas. Now, get me wrong about the gamins. In fact, one of my new traditions going forth is to become something of a gamin maker. I tried it twice already and it didn't look so bad. I think on our GC family day, we hosted a bunch of people from our GC, and I made a gammon for the first time. And I think the guys weren't lying when they said it was good, right, Susan? It wasn't a lie, it was the truth. And so now I think going forward, every Christmas for me is going to be about gammon, you know? So don't get me wrong. I'm not saying we don't do these things. I'm not saying we don't eat, we don't celebrate, we don't fellowship. Of course, these things are good. These things bring us together. The gifts are good, exchanging and getting. But put Jesus at the center of it. Put Jesus as the one who came to the world to forgive you and my sins. The angel says that Jesus will save his people from their sins. This is in line with all the promise that God has been telling in the stories of the Bible when God first created the world in Genesis. That God made people, and he made people to worship and live for him. Sin enters into the world and people live their own lives, their own way. It's my way or the highway. And God from the very beginning sends a picture of a promise, the serpent crusher. And if you turn each page going forward, right till you get to the book of Revelation, you are forever searching for the one who will bring an end to sin and evil and wickedness. And Mary is the one carrying that promise. This is what Joseph needs to understand. This is what we have come to celebrate even on this very day. That the baby in Mary's womb is the savior of the world. We often sing, Mary had a little lamb whose fleece was white as snow. We should scratch that and say, Mary had a baby boy who is the savior of the world. And I wonder if you actually, in your life, in your practice, in your thinking, you know this. You live in light of this, that Jesus has come into the world to save sinners. And Paul so powerfully says later on in one of his writings, This is a true saying. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. I don't know if you are familiar with, and I'm sure we are all familiar with the writings of Shakespeare. One of his writings, Romeo and Juliet, has this line of what's in a name. And what he means by that is that the person's name means nothing except the character of their living and way of doing things. But if Shakespeare wrote that in Jesus' time, he would be shown how wrong he was. There's everything in a name when it comes to the name Jesus. For this name, Jesus, is the Hebrew equivalent of what we call Joshua or Yeshua, which means my Lord saves, God saves. So you could imagine in this vision, in this dream, Joseph has been told the wonders of all that God has ever promised, that what Mary is carrying is a salvation for the world. My God saves. And notice that he says it is his people. We belong to God. Whether we live like it or not, that is a reality. God made the world. God made mankind. And if we continue to live in rebellion, forgetting that he is an author that can make us right, we are living lives that are mostly to be pitied. And I wonder if you really, really grasp the significance of what the angel is saying to Joseph about Mary's unborn child. I wonder if you grasp why we desperately need to be saved. Why the only hope that we have is Jesus. Because no matter how good we can be, we are never going to be good enough without Jesus. No matter how many things we can do and achieve in this world, they won't count for anything without Jesus. You see, in thinking and preparing for this sermon, one of the things that amazed me was just how advanced our world has come to be in the area of removing things that one doesn't want to see. I was thinking about how Omo is so powerful in removing those stains in fabric. I was thinking how, you know, painting over a wall. I visited a friend recently and I can see that he's just let his child grow free, drawing nicely on the walls, lines up and down. And he's like, nah, the time will come when I'll just paint over the whole thing. So for now, let the child be free. But there's nothing, there's no Omo, there's no paint that can cover the stain of sin that resides in our hearts. Only Jesus, God saves, can do that. And this is the news about Christmas. And this is why Jesus was born. And I'm not saying that the other things that make the world a problematic place to live, crime, racism, drugs, wars, poverty, that those things don't exist and all those things don't need changing. But what I am saying is the bigger problem is what resides in our hearts. There's a statement that goes something like this. We are sinful more than we can ever imagine. Yet we are loved more than we could ever dream. And that is the beauty of what Jesus brings into the world, to remove a stain that is in your heart and in my heart. He came to save his people from their sins. I just want to digress a little bit and show you what kind of people Jesus has actually come to save, because the chapter one of that story gives us a long genealogy, names that we can't even pronounce when we really think long and hard about it. But those names are there for a very particular reason, and they are to paint a picture for us of the kind of people Jesus has come to save. Because in the world, there are two kinds of people. In the world, there are people who think they don't need God, they're not that bad, they're not Hitler, they're not Idi Amin, so they're not that bad, they're okay with God. And then there are people in the world who think, I'm too wicked. God can't ever save this. God can't ever change what I've done, who I've become. And the list of names in the genealogy is quite amazing when you really read and reflect and think on it. Because it says to us that Jesus saves everyone who will acknowledge that need will come to him for that offer of sins forgiveness. If you think on the names, I just want to focus on some of them, not all of them. You know, you will notice that in the names, when you go home sometime, maybe when your belly is full with the gammon and the chicken and everything, you can maybe find a moment and read and reflect on this. And you will notice that in this list, there's peasants and prostitutes and kings and servants and women in this list that comes to us saying that Jesus is of this line. And these women and these people were saved by God and were given a purpose to live lives that bring God glory. One of these people was King David. Now, King David is known as the greatest king in Israel, but we all know that King David was a man who decided not to go to war one day, looked from the roof of his building, saw a woman bathing, thought he should have her. And David committed adultery. And after David committed adultery, he tried to hide that sin by calling the husband of this woman to come have a party with him and go and sleep with his wife. And when the man didn't do it, David committed murder. And he got this man to be put in the front lines of the war where the war was at its most fierce. And this man died without knowing that his wife was carrying the king's child. And yet David, the king of Israel, is in the line where Jesus, our Savior, comes. There's another story. It's the story of Rahab. Rahab is a prostitute. When you read Joshua chapter 2, she hears of the wonders of God saving these people called the Israelites. And he hides these spies so that they can have access to the land and see where God is sending them for victory. She's in this line and hailed as the one that God saved and purposed for the kingdom of the world that God is establishing. You see, in the time that these things were written, for the people who would have read these things, one of the most despicable things to ever get a mention in the world of the Jews at that time was women had no name, women had no significance. In fact, one of the greatest prayers of a righteous, faithful Jew would be, get up in the morning and speak loud for all to hear, I thank God that I am not a slave, a Gentile, or a woman. And yet God says, look at this list of people. Look at these people who are the unmentionables. I've used them. These people are part of my line. The Savior of the world comes through these people. And so if you are one who thinks you don't need saving, you are wrong. If you're the one who thinks that you've done too much to be saved, you are wrong. The salvation that Jesus has come to offer is for all who will see the need and come to him. So the forgiveness that Jesus brings in the words that the angel speaks to Joseph is that what Mary's carrying is a hope of the world. It is the one thing that will set the world aright again with God, a world that has gone terribly wrong. Man, this light is making me see glory. Woo! So let me just clean myself up a little bit. The second and last thing I just want us to think about before asking the big question, well, why does it matter to us, is that not only is this name, Jesus, significant because of what Jesus will do, the other name that is, of course, given to Jesus is Emmanuel, which is God with us. This is what we've come to celebrate about Christmas Day. We've come to celebrate and think and know of the reality that actually God is in our midst. That God took on flesh, that God dressed in humanity, walked the earth for our sake. And this verse actually has so much significance for the people of Israel, for the original audience of these words, Because these words come from Isaiah that Gerard read for us. The promise there is that at a certain time, God will bring a rescuer for his people. At this time, they'd gone into Babylon because of their rebellion against God, because of their sin. But God had always promised to bring them back. And the vision that is given through the prophet Isaiah is that this will happen, that a virgin will have a child, and these are the names that are given to this child. And one of these names that stands out is that his name will be Emmanuel, which means God with us. So can you take a moment and reflect and think about those two things? That when it comes to the 25th of December, this very day, we are reflecting and thinking about something quite significant, something quite, I don't even know the word, mammoth. It's a wowing wow thing that is happening today. The Savior of the world, who forgives people their sins, is being born. God with us has come to dwell with his people. So what do you do with this? What do I do with this information? Well, I think the very best response is the one that comes to us in the very next chapter of this book. In chapter 2, verses 10 to 11, we read these words. When they saw the star, this is now the wise men who've been searching for this king. In fact, that they were not part of God's people. They knew that God would do something great for his people, that God would send a rescuer. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary's mother, and they fell to the ground and worshipped him. So that is a fitting response for such a day as today. When you acknowledge and realize who Jesus is, the Savior of the world, who offers forgiveness of sins, no matter how dark your sins may be, when you realize that Jesus is God with us, the only response worth having is exceeding joy and bowing down in worship. This is God's greatest gift to mankind. This is God's greatest gift to you and me. The Savior of the world come down to forgive sins. Let me end with the angel's word in verse 21. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are God with us. We thank you that coming into the world, you came for one reason, to save us, to show us who God truly is. Not only to save us, but to give us purpose in our lives, that we may live lives of worth and meaning. As we look at the genealogy of the kinds of people that you hail from, peasants and prostitutes, the unwanted, the nobodies, the Savior of the world comes from these. And so we can have hope and certainty that no matter how far we've strayed, if we will acknowledge and realize on this day, Christmas Day, that the Savior of the world has come, we will know life in all of its meaning. And we pray that we may not lose sight of that in all of the rejoicing around Christmas, in all of the eating and celebrating and fellowshipping, that we won't forget that Jesus is the Savior of our souls. We thank you that this word is true today as it was back then, and we pray that we may live in light of it. In the name of Jesus, for his glory, amen.
Thanks, Sans. We're gonna have an opportunity now to respond to what Sans has said. There's a new song we're gonna sing. If you want to sit and just let the words wash over you, or if you want to stand, if you want to kneel, you can do that. The lyrics are speak to the heart of God, the fact that God is a good, good father. And as Sans has shared with us, that Christmas is about God with us and God forgiving us for our sins. It flows from God's heart and who he is, a loving father towards us. So we can stand or sit and listen to this song.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Father, thank you that we are indeed loved by you and that your heart towards us is one of love and kindness. And thank you for Jesus. Thank you that you have drawn near to us in our brokenness. And thank you that God is with us this Christmas. Amen. Yeah, thank you for joining us. Merry Christmas to you. Thank you to the Zoomers who have joined. God bless you. Warm well. Have a good Christmas day. Enjoy that gammon together. God bless you.